How about this fellow then? He's a pretty spiffy looking dude, isn't he? This is Gustav Eiffel, and we all know what his main achievement was. At nearly 1,000 feet in height, the Eiffel Tower was built for the 1889 World Fair in Paris, and at the time it was the tallest man-made structure on Earth, with no fewer than 18,000 wrought iron components and 2.5 million rivets. Eiffel's masterpiece would quite simply not have been possible using any other material available at the time. Everyone in Paris hated it, of course. They thought it was monstrously vulgar and an insult to the very soul of the fraternité. But Eiffel saw it as a symbol of the progress he predicted in the 20th century. And he wasn't wrong, was he? The wrought iron material that Eiffel used was vastly improved by other industrialists like Henry Bessemer, who worked out how to regulate the carbon content in iron using oxygen to mass-produce steel. And by 1930, the steel-framed Chrysler Building in New York had taken the prize for world's tallest building, followed closely by one of the world's most iconic steel constructions, the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco, which was completed in 1937. Nowadays, of course, steel is everywhere in our modern society, from the tools and machines we use in our homes through to major infrastructure works like hospitals, offices and factories, to name just a few, all of which we take completely for granted. And steel will also play a crucial role in the renewable energy transition, with solar panels, wind turbines, hydroelectric dams and electric vehicles all depending on it to one degree or another. So it's pretty ironic that the iron and steel sector ranks first when it comes to CO2 emissions and second when it comes to energy consumption. According to the International Energy Agency, the sector directly accounts for 2.6 billion tonnes of carbon dioxide emissions every year, which is 7% of the global total from the energy system, and more than the emissions from all road freight. Unsurprisingly then, the race is on to establish ways to minimise carbon dioxide emissions from steel production. Just simply building in greater efficiencies isn't going to be enough though. Manufacturers urgently need to find ways to completely reimagine the process. Luckily for them, recent advances in renewable energy technology look like they could be leading us towards the previously unthinkable goal of virtually fossil-free steel. Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. Convincing iron ore to split up and release its ferrous bounty for steelmaking currently requires a lot of energy and a lot of carbon. That comes in the form of coke, which is produced by superheating coal in the absence of oxygen. The reaction gets rid of lots of coal impurities and leaves the coke with a much higher carbon content, but it also results in nearly 800 kilograms of carbon dioxide being released for every tonne of coke produced. That coke is then added to iron ore and limestone and tossed into a furnace where air is blasted in at temperatures of about 1,000 degrees Celsius via jets in the base. That's why it's called a blast furnace. Oxygen in the air burns the coke at temperatures around 1,600 degrees Celsius, which reduces the iron ore to iron oxide and then to molten iron, known as hot metal. The limestone's there to react with other impurities in the ore to produce a liquid slag that can be skimmed off. The byproducts of the process are carbon monoxide and yet more carbon dioxide. And this one's even worse than coke production. For every tonne of molten iron produced in a blast furnace, about 1.2 tonnes of CO2 is emitted. The resultant molten iron has a carbon content of about 4%, which is far too high for steel. At that concentration, the material is very brittle, which is not what you want if you're building an office block or anything else for that matter. And that's where Sir Henry Bessemer comes in. The molten iron gets transferred into a modern-day version of Bessemer's original converter, nowadays known as a basic oxygen furnace, or BOF, where a very precisely controlled amount of air is injected in at extremely high pressure. And that causes oxygen to react with some of the unwanted carbon in the iron, which brings the carbon content down to somewhere between 1 and 1.5%, at which point you've essentially got steel, which you can then pull out from the bottom of the vessel and draw into whatever shape and size is required. The reaction of oxygen and molten iron is exothermic. In other words, it kicks out an awful lot of heat, so much so that the liquid steel that's produced would be too hot for casting. So about 25% of the mix is actually scrap steel, which draws this excess heat off as it melts, keeping temperatures down to manageable levels. And scrap steel can also just be remelted on its own in an electric arc furnace, or EAF, bypassing the blast furnace process altogether. Steel is actually one of the most recycled materials in the world today. About 30% of new steel is recycled from scrap, and making new steel from scrap only takes about an eighth of the energy compared to making it from iron ore. But steel production volumes are much higher today than when the products that are currently being recycled were produced. So that still leaves 70% of new steel being made from iron ore. The IEA Sustainable Development Scenario states that the average direct CO2 emission intensity of steel production needs to decline by 60% by 2050. We could just try to bottle the CO2 using the theoretically hopeful concept of carbon capture, utilisation and storage, or CCUS. And sure enough, the IEA does include this technology in its scenario projection. But in order for CCUS to play a meaningful role, the IEA calculated it would need to be preventing 400 million tonnes of CO2 escaping each year by 2050. And to achieve that, a 1 million tonne per annum CCUS facility would have to come online every 2 to 3 weeks from 2030 onwards. But growing access to low renewable electricity in many countries around the world is providing a competitive advantage to a technology called hydrogen-based direct reduced iron, or HDR. A full assessment of the process was carried out by Valentin Vogel, Max Arman and Lars Nilsson in this 2018 paper published in Science Direct. I've melted my brain reading this paper, so you don't have to. But I have left a link to it in the description box below this video, just in case you're feeling particularly sciencey today. The basic idea is this. Water is split into hydrogen and oxygen in an electrolyzer powered by renewables. That's a technology we looked at in a recent video, which you can jump back to by clicking up there somewhere. The hydrogen replaces the coke that would normally be added to the iron oxide to reduce it. The hydrogen reacts with iron oxide at the relatively low temperature of about 800 degrees Celsius to make what the industry calls sponge iron. And if you're keen to understand sponge iron, then there's a link in the description to a second Science Direct paper that explains it all in minute detail. Make sure you've got a strong coffee on the go first though, eh? Anyway, the byproduct of hydrogen direct reduction is no longer carbon dioxide, but simply water, which can be recycled back into the hydrogen electrolyzer. The sponge iron now doesn't need to go through a blast furnace. It can be charged straight into an electric arc furnace, along with recycled scrap iron. You do still need to add some carbon to make the iron into steel, though. There's no getting away from that law of physics. And there will still be some impurities to remove too. So lime and carbon sources are both added to the electric arc furnace as well. But because the iron ore reduction work has been done by hydrogen instead of coke, the researchers found that this method emits only 2.8% of the carbon dioxide currently churned out by existing coke and blast furnace systems. They also calculated that HDR uses 3.4 megawatt hours of electricity for every tonne of steel produced, and they say that would make it cost competitive against an existing integrated steel plant only if there was an internationally mandated carbon price of between 34 and 68 euros per tonne of CO2, and assuming electricity cost of 40 euros per megawatt hour. Those are big assumptions, but it's quite likely that every major carbon dioxide emitter on the planet is going to have to get used to the reality of carbon pricing in the near future. And one of the big bonuses of the hydrogen reduction system is flexibility in production and electricity demand, which could allow for grid balancing through storage of hydrogen. The Swedish Energy Agency has calculated that this process could reduce the CO2 emissions of their entire country by up to 10%. It's supporting a major project called Hydrogen Breakthrough Iron Making Technology, or HYBRIT, being developed jointly by steel producer SSAB, iron ore mining company LKAB, and power company Vattenfall. The initial production plant in Sweden is costing around 150 million euros, with a government subsidy of 50 million. Initially, it'll produce a comparatively modest amount of 1 metric ton of steel per hour, but in the medium-term future, it's expected to expand that to as much as 200 tons per hour. SSAB also say that their steelmaking operations in Iowa will be powered by renewable energy by 2022, and that all their Americas operations will be able to offer fossil-free steel products starting in 2026, utilising the sponge iron developed using this new hybrid technology. At the same time, they say they've started the process of phasing out fossil fuels used in rolling mills and heat treatment plants throughout the company to reach their corporate goal of becoming fossil-free by 2045. As steel markets in the big consuming economies like China and India start to mature, the availability of scrap material for recycling will increase, of course, and that's a good thing. But nevertheless, the IEA still warns that new technologies will need to be deployed at a blistering pace, with new infrastructure to go alongside them. In the case of hydrogen direct reduction, they reckon it'll need to account for at least 15% of all primary steel production by 2050, and that equates to one new plant every month for at least two decades, starting in 2030. A sustainable transition for the iron and steel sector won't happen on its own though. As with so many of the new technologies we've looked at on this channel, governments will need to play a key role. Although 2050 is often used as the target date, the IEA argues that governments and decision makers should have 2030 firmly in mind as the critical window to accelerate the transition. Heavy subsidies will most likely be needed to help pay for the capital expenditure to get these industrial scale processes up and running. And of course, a global carbon pricing structure will be absolutely essential. That'll no doubt be the topic of great discussion at the pivotal COP26 climate conference in November 2021. If you've got direct experience in the field, or if you have strong opinions about this technology one way or another, then dive down to the comment section below and leave your thoughts there. That's it for this week though. Thanks to our fantastic Patreon supporters who help keep the channel independent and keep these videos ad-free. You can support the channel in that way too and receive exclusive monthly news updates from me, plus content polls to choose each month's topics by visiting www.patreon.com/justhaveathink. And of course, you can hugely support the channel absolutely for free by subscribing and hitting that like button. And if you want to be notified about new content each week, make sure you hit that little bell icon too. Dead easy to subscribe. Just click down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week. And remember to just have a think. See you next week.